What do you see about social entrepreneurship these days, especially in South Asia?
So the landscape is changing significantly because of, you know, early stage movers like Acumen Fund, which is based in New York and run by Jacqueline Novogratz. They've actually devised a fantastic new model of social entrepreneurship where they require that their recipients of their grants or their, you know, their loans return not only the capital to them, but they even give them a profit. So this is very new in the philanthropic world, and they are actually, you know, blazing a road ahead for the rest of us. Family foundations that are trying to go in a similar route. I think what's changing pretty radically now is that the traditional grant-making model of a donor writing a check to an NGO in the third world is kind of changing now, and more you find donor families, donor organizations like Google.org, or philanthropic foundations based in universities and so on, are now requiring that the recipient has a sustainable model of giving capital back, actually, which is putting a different kind of pressure on these NGOs, and it's a great thing for both parties. The donor party gets the funding back and they recycle it back into their foundations, and the recipients are forced to think about a business model. So even in the lowest income areas, even in slum schools, like there's one I'm working with right now called Gyan Shala in Ahmedabad in India, we require that even the rag pickers whose children we are funding give us back 100 rupees a month, which is about $1.50 a month for getting access for education for the children. So this model is brand new, and I think a lot of NGOs and a lot of foundations out there are applying this kind of a model. That's one big thing. The second thing I think that's driving this change in social entrepreneurship in India, at least, is that a lot of the organizations here, the ones which are based in the United States, are actually collaborating with each other also. And a lot of them, especially the family foundations, are saying that we don't want to be just writing a check to, let's say, donor-advised funds. I'm not sure how many of you here know of something called Community Foundation, which is based in San Jose here, which typically what it does is it serves as a conduit for high net worth families to write a check. The families write a check and then they walk away for an NGO. This model has changed because NGOs the donors have started collaborating now. And what they're saying is we actually want to get a feel for what we are investing in. We want to see who we are impacting. And so for somebody like me, my return on investment is not just that the recipient is returning my capital, but that I get to see who is being affected by this grant or by a loan or even sort of an equity investment. And often I get to meet the people, I get to go to the NGO on the ground and see who are the recipients. I see the children who are being benefited. So for a lot of us these days, it is changing, and we are defining our own ROI as the first-hand look at what's going on there.
Can I follow up for a second and ask, it almost sounds like you've taken more of a venture capital approach to hands-on relationship with the managers of the ventures that you're investing in. Is it similar to that?
Absolutely. I think it could be because venture capitalists are now creeping into this world of social philanthropy and realizing that our own ROI is not necessarily just the capital that we're getting back, but our own ROI is actually being able to go into that slum, for example, in Kibera in Nairobi, and looking at these entrepreneurs. The social entrepreneurs are exactly of the same mindset and perhaps even similar DNA as for-profit, mm-hmm. Yeah. Startup entrepreneurs in the Bay Area. They all have exactly the same vision of wanting to change the world, of wanting to make it big, wanting to make a big impact. And so because VCs and sort of all of us who have been in the startup community in the Valley are getting into this world, we are requiring that we put that kind of pressure on those entrepreneurs. And it seems to work wonderfully for them.
Okay. I do have one more question before we ask Radhika for some comments. And this is, do you see a change in the type of philanthropic activity that can be supported? Certainly, not everything could come up with a sustainable business model in terms of generating profit, right?
Yes.
So does this make some traditional things that people used to do as social service more difficult?
Well, I would say there are investments which are which are straight out philanthropic grants. And those would be things like in disaster management. Let's say a tsunami hits a town. Those are grants. Those are straight out grants.
Right.
So for earthquakes, tsunamis, natural disasters, it's all straight out grants. But then there are also the sort of the middle areas where it is, you know, eye operations for senior citizens in India, mm-hmm. let's say. Now, typically, it would have been a grant 20 years ago. Somebody would have said, how can you ask, you know, people who are getting the surgery for a better vision to return some of your capital? But actually, people are willing to pay for these things. And once they have a skin in the game, mm-hmm. it's a win-win for everybody.
Yeah, I think that the benefits of having the people who are receiving benefit recognize that benefit mm-hmm. in some way. There's a psychology there that also actually probably improves the quality of the service.
There is a huge study that has, in fact, there's a huge book that has come out which says, what drives us? I think something like, what actually drives us? You know, when people have that pressure to pitch in their skin in the game into this whole project, there's a sense of self-respect that evolves. There's a sense of responsibility that evolves in this whole relationship. So it's never this one way, you know, I'm donating and, you know, you're receiving, that kind of thing. You're making the relationship equal.
Okay.
And that's an unintended side effect, but it's happening and it's fantastic.
The quality of the relationship is a very good outcome. Before we change, would you explain this slide to us a little bit?
So these are the, you know, multiple kind of areas where both Rajiv and I have been investing, and maybe I'll just
use the cursor if you want to.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, this will work.
So these are various areas where we've been, you know, sort of helping on various things. We sort of invested in things like, for example, Maker Faire Africa. So the Maker Faire Africa is something, those of you who are familiar with Maker Faire California, because of the impact that I've seen in California of sort of people coming out of the woodworks and showing their inventions. These are often tinkerers who don't really want to be in the public eye. They want to, they've been hiding in the cottages or in the garage. Once we had the Maker Faire Africa launched, the kind of people that came out of the woodworks started showing their inventions, like this young lady who had, a young girl in Ghana, who came up with a way to generate electricity actually from urine. And it was amazing what they did. So these kind of inventions normally don't have a place where they can be showcased and celebrated. Mm-hmm. So once I saw the success of Maker Faire in Africa, I also took it to India last year. And it's now taken off from just my own hometown. It has taken off to Bombay, Delhi, Cochin, you know, Bangalore, and places like that. So these are all areas where both Rajiv and I have been doing kind of, you know, some of them are, well, actually mm-hmm. none of these are grants. So Acumen Fund is the one which is in New York where we are partners. That's right, the big one. That's where we are partners. And Acumen Fund has been around for about 10 years and they've been working mostly on clean water and green tech. But now they are also moving into education. And that's where I am kind of influential on their, you know, mm-hmm. in their partnership there. And that's where I'm learning. Actually, as a foundation, we are trying to emulate their model because mm-hmm. we are seeing huge benefit in giving that kind of responsibility to the recipient. So these are multiple things that we've been investing in. IIT Kanpur, IIT Gandhinagar, these are all places where IIT Kanpur, we've set up a new building of computer science, which will also have an incubator. So there, and this is about a $1.5 million donation to IIT Kanpur. That actually is a donation in a way. Technically, it's a donation. Mm-hmm. But I'm keeping a strong hold on what we're going to do with this building. So it's not just naming it after Rajiv, but it's also saying, I want to see his vision come mm-hmm. true in IIT Kanpur. I want to be able to see young faculty and students in IIT Kanpur who, in case they want to drop out, mm-hmm. could drop out and be in our incubator and be in our accelerator. And this has never been done in India before. You just don't have that situation where, you know, a young faculty member with an invention or an idea is able to take a sabbatical for a year or two and work on an idea in a sustainable sort of a way. No, but I mean, it just hasn't happened before.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, it's fantastic that we have this opportunity with IIT Kanpur.
Tell you what, we will come back and talk more about the impact investing area. First, I'd like to ask Radhika to give us some comments. How do you want to do this, Radhika? Do you want to sit over here and manipulate the slides yourself, or shall I just move the slides for you?
Move them.
Okay.
So I'd like to introduce Ashoka and talk about social impact and returns in that context. So Ashoka is one of the largest networks of social entrepreneurs in the world, and some people have equated Ashoka to be the friendly venture capitalist of the social sector. Ashoka is very focused on grants. Ashoka is also focused on people, not projects. So we find the very best people and social entrepreneurs who are working on a very innovative idea that is changing the entire ecosystem, the system level change, and has the potential to scale to a very large area, not just national, but continent level. Yes. So those are the people, Ashoka.
How many people here have heard of the Ashoka Fellows? Okay, so that's good.
Yeah. So maybe we could switch slides. So this is a quote from Bill Drayton, the very inspiring founder of Ashoka. According to Bill, a social entrepreneur is not someone who gives someone a fish. They don't even teach people how to fish. They revolutionize the entire fishing industry. And so that is the essence of Ashoka Fellow, and those are the type of people we look for and nominate as fellows.
Okay.
And so to the topic of today, how do we measure success? And that Ashoka's approach of looking at impact is not monetary, because Ashoka gives grants, but it is very, very rigorous and the very clear criteria. And the next slide gives us a little bit of a flavor. So Ashoka looks at, as I mentioned, finding the innovative entrepreneurs who can scale. A good 90% of Ashoka fellows have scaled nationally. The way scaling nationally is defined at Ashoka is that other people emulating the model of this fellow. Are the governments adapting this idea and bringing it all over the country? And that's happening with a large number of fellows. Also, is the national policy impacted? So 60% of fellows have affected national policy within 5 years of being elected and nominated. So these are some other examples of how Ashoka measures success. Are marginalized sections of society being pulled in and being more included? That's happening with a large percent of the fellows who focus on that area. Is there a collaboration and congruence between the social and the business sector? That's again happening. I won't get into all the stats because today's topic is India, but this is how we measure impact at Ashoka. So what I'm doing right now, along with my co-founder, Darlene Tam, who's not here with us today, is a group of volunteers have started Ashoka Silicon Valley chapter. We're looking at engaging the world of Silicon Valley with social entrepreneurs all across the world. Ashoka fellows visit here, and they meet people like Asha, who often support their work, other philanthropists. They meet technologists. And so in a sense, there is a lot of connection happening between Silicon Valley and the Ashoka global ecosystem. And that's been just an amazing experience the last year. Welcome you all to join and talk to us if you're interested. And so that's a chapter. And then I would love to jump into two or three case studies of Ashoka fellows in India. This is Kabir Vajpayee, who was with us here just a month ago. What Kabir is doing in the social sector is bringing, it's a very out-of-the-box idea. He's an architect who believes that education is not just about what you learn in schools. It is about the environment in which you learn, and the environment influences people through various different senses. So he's bringing design elements to schools. He's designing very creative things like sandboxes that are shaped like maps, security window grids that teach you fractals, flagpole whose shade teaches you about sundials. So he's going and doing this in rural India, transforming schools. What is amazing about his model is that he's got several state governments to be his champions, not only invest in him, but get him access to schools in various states. And this is something that's very unique about Ashoka fellows, that, and this is how we measure success, that have they managed to get all stakeholders, governments, NGOs, teachers, and working collaboratively in a solution. So this is one such fellow, very, very successful. And this is another fellow, Hasina Karbi. So Ashoka is agnostic to the sector. It has to be a major social problem. It could be any part of the world, any area. So you'll see this as a wide range of fellows. Hasina is taken on the very hard problem of human trafficking and looking at it holistically. She started in the eastern states of India. She started looking at how can you prevent it? How can you find how it is happening and where are the victims? How can she rescue them and bring them back? How can she train them and rehabilitate them so they have a dignified life, employment, vocational training? Taking it all on, and she's extremely successful in India. And now she's so successful that countries like Myanmar, Nepal are inviting her to replicate the model. But the reason she could succeed is she got the state government, the law enforcers, who were earlier being very, very challenging to work with, she's got them to be her champions. She's got NGOs to work with her. She's got the the whole thinking change. The victims, instead of thinking of themselves as victims, she's got them thinking of themselves as the people who are going to bring the change and very active protagonists in the whole process. And that is what makes Ashoka Fellow successful. But in India, particularly, a model has been extremely successful, and there's a lot of change happening in India right now, where multiple stakeholders are coming together and partnering on solutions. I see that with Asha's work as well. And then that's leading the change that's coming to other parts of the world. And I do want to mention that this Hasina was here as part of an exchange here at Stanford earlier in March. Several fellows, Ashoka fellows from across the world, from Kenya, Egypt, Mexico, India, working on women's rights. And we could bring them here because philanthropists like Asha actually helped sponsor their trip. And then they could meet people here, and brilliant ideas came out of that. So the world is becoming a small place now. And then the last fellow I'll quickly touch on is Cindy Kaplan. Cindy, again, is doing innovation in a very unique manner. She has discovered that at a systemic level, there's a problem where orphans, foster children, marginalized children in society, they're very malnutritioned. And this is a fixable problem detected early, but they're so malnutrition that nobody wants to adopt them because they don't look very pretty when they're very unwell. So she's tackling it in a very interesting way. What she's realizing is it's not just lack of access to good food and nutrition, it is also the way these children are fed. When caregivers are not looking at the child, like often she sees in India, some of the caregivers were not looking at the child when feeding the child. In some other countries, they were not holding the child, and this actually affects how nutrition is absorbed. So she's developed a whole template that she's learning from different countries and bringing to various different countries. She's doing this in China, India, Kazakhstan. She hopes to bring this model to 20 countries in 10 years, and that's how her success will be measured. So that was Ashoka, and I wanted to briefly touch on a few non-Ashoka social entrepreneurs from Silicon Valley. Summersource is bringing digital microwork, leveraging technology to bring work from places like Stanford and Google to places like Sub-Saharan Africa, India. And she's able to do this using internet technology. Another such social entrepreneur at CG Netswara is using cell phones in tribal India to train local villagers to report on what is happening in their world. Often it's human rights abuses, and using mobile phones, just basic phones, get the news out, and it's shared across India, then it's there in the newspapers. And the way they measure impact, in Leila's case at Summersource, the impact is about how many women get employment, and what does it do through the dignity that they experience in their life? How do others treat them when they get the work? That's how they measure success. So the CG Netswara measures success by how many human rights violations are detected and stopped. So these are a few examples of results we're seeing in India.
So back to the Ashoka program for a little bit. The fellows are selected really as individuals.
Yes.
It's not their organizations that they've created. But if someone has a vision but they don't have the organizing skills, what happens?
That is part of selecting the fellows. So while the fellows are selected, they're selected for who they are, the ethical fiber of them as a human being, but the other criteria is, do they have an idea that is innovative and has the potential to scale, and do these feel like people who can make it scale?
So generally, before being selected as a fellow, someone has already demonstrated some results?
Absolutely, they've shown some success and the potential to scale.
So how is this impacting India? What are the results? Are you seeing generally an impact on the economy or the situation in India?
Economy overall is hard for me to tell at this stage, but there is significant impact in the social sector in India. The three people that I mentioned, they are having a huge impact. So Hasina is one of the leaders in the trafficking space. She has brought back so many of the trafficked women who have even been sent outside the country by leveraging the law authorities, working with the visa, the immigration. Mm-hmm. So the impact in the social sector is huge that these fellows are having, and very, very measurable.
Okay.
And they also are acting as role models for many other social entrepreneurs in India and across the world. I do want to mention that India is also very special for Ashoka. While Ashoka is a global nonprofit, Bill Drayton was inspired when he was in Gandhi Ashram in India, hence the name Ashoka. So there are a lot of Ashoka's work's focus is in India.
Okay.
I think, how is it having impact at a national level? I think for a lot of people in the development world, you know, United Nations, you know, Aspen Institute, all these guys, I think they're all looking to see how cities can sustain or can be actually protected from mass migrations. Mm-hmm. So that's, again, a huge impact. You'll have in a lot of the NGOs that are successful rurally, the biggest ROI for national governments is that people are staying in the rural areas. They're not migrating to the cities and creating a pressure on the cities where the systems break down. Uh-huh. And you know, and I think even from a Western perspective, we're looking at a reduction in the carbon footprint. We are looking at the reduction in mass migrations and therefore pressures on housing, mm-hmm. on use of renewable resources, and on you know, just on consumption of steel and water.
Yeah.
These are things that we in the West also are watching actually and saying, you know, things like consumption of water is a big thing. Actually, I didn't know that. But if people stay in the rural areas and strengthen their communities, that actually has a tangible sort of a GDP impact, if you know, so to speak.
It does, provided people feel that they're staying because opportunity is there, not That's, because they're being kept there.
No, it's because of opportunity. And and these new models, right, of, mm-hmm. of investing are because they're requiring that there's profit being generated. Uh-huh. A lot of the work that is being done in the rural areas is getting respectful sort of interest. People do believe that doing, you know, farming, doing livestock farming and so on is giving profits, and you know.
Yeah. So I one question for me, and then we'll open the floor. There are many ways to make something sustainable, and one is to aim at scale, right? To scale up to a size where it kind of basically supports itself, and maybe even gives a return. Is that what you're looking at when you're evaluating potential investments? Or, you know, Asha, I'd like to ask it to you in that way, and then Radhika, I'd mm-hmm. like to ask you. So how do you transform a fishing industry, right? What are you looking for in that kind of transformation? So is
for
it scaling?
For me personally, what would be really interesting and what I'm looking actually to get is, for example, if I put in a dollar, I want a matching dollar of, you know, funding coming from Indian government, Indian state government, and perhaps maybe even something like Google.org. Mm-hmm. And so that's important for us as a family foundation to show the metrics, to say that here is what we invested in education, for example. And, you know, instead of 10,000 students last year, we now have reached 100,000 students this year. Mm-hmm. And that kind of a growth is allowing us to stretch our dollar, first thing. And grow the operations. But exit, as you mentioned earlier, there is no such thing as exit in this social sector. I mean, who's going to come and acquire a wildly successful school in the cloud? Nobody's going to acquire. But that said, a lot of these NGOs are getting a lot of international recognition. They get funding from places like Google.org, which is not only just prestigious, it is not just the dollar amount, but I think they get visibility in the international stage. I mean, you have these NGOs, you know, presenting in Davos at the World Economic Forum. They're at the Aspen Institute of Ideas.
That's interesting, because that's a kind of validation that's similar to the financial validation that you have on exit.
You have a CEO of an Ashoka Foundation or one of these NGOs sitting head to head with the head of state.
Yeah, right.
In Davos, or you're sitting with you know, CEO of IBM or Coca-Cola, mm-hmm. and they're equal voice in everything.
Okay.
So at a policy level, these guys are having impact, and so it's not just, you know, it may not be a, you know, a sort of a traditional exit in that sense, but the power to really influence policy is same as being head of a business of a large group.
Yeah.
And a perfect example of that actually is the microfinance guru, Muhammad Yunus.
Yeah.
I mean, look at Yunus. He could be sitting there with Dalai Lama, and with President Clinton, having same impact.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
that's a good point. Yeah. Thank you. So, Radhika, transforming fishing industries, what kind of transformational things are you looking for when you're talking to potential?
So first, touching on the sustainability aspect, to Ashoka often funds nonprofits as well as for profits, and not looking for necessarily a return in terms of people becoming profitable. On the other hand, that said, there is the expectation that Ashoka provides the first 3 years of a fellowship, covers the fellow for roughly operating costs for 3 years in the region. There is the expectation that afterwards the fellow, that is like getting them off the ground. they figure out a way of being sustainable, and that may be in the form of, similar to what Asha is talking of, finding other grants, finding a way to go to the next level, and financially finding a way, whether it's through their own revenues or through donations. And in terms of transforming the fishing industry, that part is more about whatever the goal is of the organization, achieving that and achieving it in a very novel way where within the ecosystem, all the stakeholders think very differently and there is something transformational happening. Mm-hmm. So in Cindy's case, the orphans case, to transforming the fishing industry is, so it's not just about providing nutrition to infants, but making the caregivers, the parents, the NGOs, governments aware that the thing we talked about, that how you hold the child, what else could there be that's different? What is happening within the ecosystem that could be a problem, and transforming that, transforming the thinking, transforming some of the way things are done, and doing it to the goal of scaling this at a national and regional level. That is what Ashoka would consider transforming the fishing industry. Okay. In Hasina's case, tackling trafficking in this holistic manner and doing things. So one example to one of the earlier questions, Professor Dasher on that Asha was talking about, that having enterprise in rural areas. So Hasina is, so what she's doing is when she rescues women and she vocationally trains them, she actually has them in rural areas come up with beautiful crafts which are from their region and train them to do these crafts and be sustainable. So very much the point Asha was making, that they're able to stay in places where they're safe and secure and in the known world and be very successful entrepreneurs. So now it's transforming the industry to turn these people into entrepreneurs and having them think themselves how they would become entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. and very successful ones. So that is transforming it versus just saving a victim, changing the way they think.
Yeah, right. That's
also
a good point.
Because of technology, what's happening, another very interesting shift that I'm seeing in the last 5 years, is all the NGOs are interconnected.
Yes.
So they have kind of voting muscle that we have never seen before. And the kind of voice they have unified voice, they have best practices that they share, and there's a lot of transparency in how they report, how they invest, how they use the capital, mm-hmm. and how they leverage it for their future projects. So technology has become a huge driver in networking these NGOs and having them have a voice which is very different from 5 years ago.
Okay. Let's open up the floor. I've got some more things I want to ask, but I'll wait and give other people a chance. Questions or comments? Yes?
I first heard about social entrepreneurship here locally, I think about 10 years ago. I'm kind of curious, are there any, in the work that you've done, have you found any negatives or downside that you realized you need to correct?
Well, I mean, there's, of course, it's like any budding industry, right? You have lots of entrepreneurs out there who don't know exactly how to proceed. As Professor Dasher was saying, like Ashoka, for example, picks only fellows who have had some success or have an organization, right? For a lot of, for me personally, having had the taste of what is a true entrepreneur in the Valley, that's what I look for when I go back to India or when I look at things in Africa. I want a true entrepreneur. Often, these folks are not organized enough. They have the energy and they have the drive, but they're not organized enough. They don't have best practices. They don't know how to put their best foot forward. And that's where a lot of us come in, actually, and we bet on these people. And most of the times, I've seen that they stumble a few times, but then they get their act together. Also, again, because of technology, the amount of transparency that has come into the whole NGO world is totally different from 5 years ago. Now you can, you know, log into their website as a donor. You can log into the website and see where the last mile where your dollar has reached. This is again completely new. This kind of compute power was never there before for an NGO. It used to cost way too much to be able to put that kind of a system in place. Now it's commodity. All they have to do is drag and drop and put something on a Dropbox maybe. And we have, as donors, have full transparency into where the money is going. How much is going into salaries? How much is going to the last mile? And, you know, how can we improve their efficiency? So this is different. And there are, mind you, now there are some ethical questions that do come up once in a while. They do. I mean, there are, you know, it's not, the system is not yet perfect. But that said, I think it's improving by the day, just because of technology and transparency.
Go ahead. I saw your hand.
Thank you for coming to today. I noticed both Ashoka and your partner, the Acumen Fund, they don't operate in China. And I was just wondering, what is holding you back primarily in terms of setting fellows or choosing fellows that operate in China or working on projects in China?
For me, I think for, you know, I mean, I don't want to speak for Acumen, but I would say there could be, my guess is right now that working in some of the, you know, states which are much more sort of centrally controlled and they, where there may be a lot of requirement or even suspicion about foreign entities coming in and investing, often, you know, that's a barrier, actually. And so the China, I think Chinese government does look at a lot of foreign money coming in with a little bit of suspicion. So that could be a barrier. In India, one of the barriers is I was just trying to invest less than $10,000 in an art biennale in India, and I could not send them the money because they said, you know, the Indian Firearms Act doesn't allow more than $5,000 to be transferred from a U.S. bank into India. I had no idea. I'm actually blown away because that NGO needs the money so badly, and they are not able to accept it unless it's going from my Indian bank account. So this is a sort of a barrier that I'm surprised. I'm surprised Indian government has done this because it's just blocking millions of dollars in aid coming in from directly from U.S.
Can I follow up on that question? Because I think that one of the things has to do with what society sort of thinks is the role of government. Mm-hmm. You know, is it really government's responsibility to solve social problems and to improve the lives of people to the extent that if you try to do it from a private sector standpoint, it's not welcome? Mm-hmm. I think that there may be some differences in that regard as well.
I think the Indian Firearms Act is purely accidental, actually incidental. It has happened because of the bombing in Bombay.
That's a regulation that has to do with moving money around.
Yes.
I'm really talking about, you know, the government should build the school. You shouldn't. Mm-hmm. You know, that kind of attitude. That where I'm coming from with this, after the big tsunami in Southeast Asia some years ago, U.S. private sector donations exceeded everybody else in the world. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The Japanese government gave more money than any other government, but there was almost no private sector donations from Japan. And it really has to do with the attitude in Japan that the government should do this. We pay high taxes, you know, the government should be doing this. Mm-hmm. And I think that looking at China, it's a kind of complex situation where you've got not just the central government, but, you know, state governments and regional governments, all of which have a role, and making sure that you get through the regulations, which is hard, but also not stepping on somebody's toes in regard to trying to do something that would surprise you.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
That you think that this is obviously a good thing, and then it's not welcome.
Yes. It's definitely a surprise. But that said, you know, unlike China, I think in places like India and even increasingly now in Africa, I find that there's a blend because these a lot of these governments have evolved from a very Russian model of economy to a very sort of a capitalist model, mm-hmm. which is Western U.S. style. I think these governments are actually themselves evolving, where you find civil society reacting in a very different way to the kind of structural changes that are happening because of shift to the Western model, but these are happening slowly, and I find that the only sort of driver for facilitating and improving this change is actually technology again.
Yeah.
But there used to be a time when there was a lot of suspicion around foreign money. There used to be you're right about the sort of the cultural thing about the government should be handling these crises. And government itself doesn't want others to come in,
right?
Because there's corruption there also. But a lot of times when you don't, government doesn't want you to open the hood,
right?
Because there is a lot of pockets that are getting lined there.
They would not be happy with this transparency to see where the money's actually going.
Totally, yeah.
So on that one, with Ashoka doesn't take any government money and works mainly with the private sector. I don't know the answer to your questions. I don't know how to speak for Ashoka, but I won't be surprised if that is a factor, the point Professor Dasher raised.
So I'd kind of like to ask, especially Radhika, are you seeing more sophistication among people who are not Americans that want to do something overseas, but who really grew up in India, who are working in India, are you seeing more sophistication in the kinds of ideas that people are coming up with?
Absolutely.
And what sort of changes?
Yeah, there are very interesting sophistication and nuances in the ideas. As Professor Dasher mentioned, I'm also involved with the group Action for India a little bit, and the organization's focused on helping social entrepreneurs in India scale. And people are coming up with amazing innovations in models, in systems, in methodology. I do see that a lot of the most cutting-edge technology innovations are still coming out from the US, and again, that's a blanket statement. Of course, there's innovations everywhere. But the most intriguing ones in the social sector do seem to come from here. But that said, there is innovations in many different areas, especially understanding the problems at an out-of-the-box solutions is something that's happening quite a bit. One example, if I may share on this, is an Ashoka fellow who has come up with a way of dealing with landmines. And it's a very creative way. He trained some rats and found that rats can actually sniff out landmines very well. So he's trained a very, very interesting group of rats that go out and they just know when there's a landmine. And so it's safe, human beings are not hurt.
Are the rats blown up? Or?
As far, I don't know, I'm an animal lover, so I've had that thought myself from the videos I've seen. It doesn't look that way because they detect it and behave a bit differently.
And probably they're not heavy enough to really set off a mine.
Exactly.
Maybe
so my sense is no, but...
Point to it or something,
yeah,
so go stand on it and don't blow it up.
Also drones. There's a huge increase in the number of drones that are used for delivering medication to disaster areas.
Right.
Drones are a big thing right now in the third world. For delivering medicines, for delivering food, and of course some amount of espionage, but which the government always conducts in areas of resistance, you know.
Yeah, Let's open the floor again.
What are the cultural differences when you export this model to another country? How do you deal with that?
Yes, tell us more. What's the question? Can you expand on that question a little bit more?
There might be cultural differences in the way someone would think about a sector, say beyond just education is the province of the government. So how do you deal if you have a particular model? Do you do due diligence on another country's cultural response to something before you would, you know, try to export it there?
I could. You want me to?
Yeah, you go first.
So Ashoka deals with this quite a bit because fellows are usually selected when they're working on the problem indigenously in that region, exactly for this reason, that they're looking at the problem in the context of the culture and solving it there. And then when they bring it to other cultures, other nations, there is, in most cases, there's a very systematic process where they work with people and partner organizations on the ground in the other regions and understand the cultural context and collectively come up with solutions. And then, since one of the goals is to scale, they then come up with templates of what is cultural, what is generic, and then the cultural aspects. There is a clear methodology in each case of when you go to a new culture. Sit down, assess, understand, and then come up with a solution. I know Cindy at Spoon does that. In every case, she has a local NGO on the ground she partners with for exactly this reason. And they have a system where they will first go and assess the situation for the culture, and only then suggest a solution in partnership with the local NGO. And so that's how Ashoka deals with it.
I think for savvy entrepreneurs on the ground, the kind of people we look for example, are the kinds who you know have gone and done their homework, and they have actually lived in the community where we are looking to invest in. So for example, you know, a solution for education in India, would it be easy to sort of say girls would walk to school, learn, you know, in a school setting with boys? We would never do that in Afghanistan.
So, in other words, sustainability has to be sustainability in the context of that culture.
Absolutely. I mean, the local.
Right? So that will be defined in different ways in different cultures.
Yeah. So in Afghanistan, for example, we would never require a girl to come out and go to school. We would rather take the teacher to the community where the moms, grandmothers, and the children are together, and the teacher is teaching in their community rather than in a school where they have to be around boys or around men. And this is a cultural sensitivity. The results for us are phenomenal if we follow the culture rather than we resist it. So, yes, I mean, absolutely.
So one of the changes that I've seen in the United States in the last maybe 5 or 6 years is when it's really started to take off, is sort of breaking down this severe distinction between nonprofit organization and for-profit company. I'm especially thinking about B Corps, where a B Corporation states in the corporate bylaws that a portion of its profits will be devoted to some sort of philanthropic activity. Are you seeing that? Is that influencing? Are a lot of the things you're looking at B Corps now?
Not really, no.
That's not that common.
Then. No, it's not. It's not that common. And in fact, what's surprising for me is that, you know, a lot of the activities that I want to pursue in India are not necessarily 501c3, you know, friendly. But the NGOs, once again, because it's such a connected world now, the good entrepreneurs there are figuring out ways to work with, you know, donors outside of India. To bypass that whole system and to figure out actually how to give equivalency.
Yeah.
So an NGO is obviously most of the NGOs I funded are not 501c3s, but they have equivalency stamped now from multiple agencies, and so it's easy to fund them from here without getting into trouble with law, with my tax guy.
Do you worry very much that if you fund something that's a for-profit, that's a bottom of the pyramid? For-profit, that it looks like you're taking advantage of people at the bottom of the pyramid rather than really delivering something good to them?
Actually, not really, because fortunately, we are late to the market. So people who were there early before us, they had to face that kind of a dilemma and had to face that kind of a rhetoric on the ground. We don't have to anymore because, you know, people have gone before us, taken the flak, taken the heat, and now when we go in, everybody understands that it's okay for a donor to say, give us our money back, and in the following format. The money is normally plowed back into the foundation, right? So, for example, whatever we get, it goes back into our foundation. We can't touch it. But it's there, and I think now, you know, now it's not sort of, I don't look like a bad cop if I go in there and if I ask, because just simply because people like Acumen Fund and all have already done this mind change and taken the heat.
Radhika, what do you see in terms of trends among the social entrepreneurs who are becoming Ashoka Fellows or that you're interacting with? Do you see a shift, say, away from education and toward resource issues, environment issues, or do you see a shift toward education? What kind of shifts are you seeing?
With Ashoka, since Ashoka covers fellows, there's 3,000,
or more than 3,000 Ashoka
fellows, and covers almost every sector.
Uh-huh.
There is plenty in education, there's plenty in the environment, and there's plenty in all these spaces.
Uh-huh.
So there, I haven't seen a trend in terms of sectors, but I do see a trend in terms of collaboration within sectors. So, for example, we brought 4 Ashoka Fellows from, as I was mentioning, across the world working on women's rights. They came here, they brainstormed. We have been thinking of maybe there should be a fund, Ashoka Fund or endowment, focused just on fellows working on women's rights, and then also collaborating with, like, brainstorming with people like Asha. So there is a big trend on how to leverage each other's work among fellows and also across organizations. So that is a big shift happening, and technology and networks are playing a role there.
Okay.
I'm understanding the model that the donor will be reimbursed by the organization, and if that is the model, and you're doing something that's sustainable from the government, how do the governments view that the donor is going to get paid back? I mean, because they might say, well, you're putting your money in, why should we pay the donor? Have you come across that as an area of resistance, a problem?
Well, you know, with the government, typically, I mean, unless we ask them to match our dollar, we typically find them sort of staying out of the way. You know, which is easy for us, and you know, but if you're asking for a matching donation, then they will look in. And a lot of us from here, especially from the Valley, are not comfortable dealing with any local governments. We just want to do our thing, we want to help our entrepreneurs, and we want to sustain an ecosystem there which is going to leverage our own technology expertise and our entrepreneurial sort of skill development and keep us out of the way of the government. Most of us are trying to avoid the government.
So when many of the people here from Silicon Valley, they're more oriented toward doing something in the private sector and not really having the sustainable aspect, which would come from government funding.
No, the sustainable aspect comes from the NGO itself, right? Because the NGO is not, see, so for example, let's say if the Gyan Shala, which I funded in Ahmedabad, it's a slum school. But because we are requiring the slum school to charge fees from the families that they are benefiting, they have their capital flows in inflows, and they are not depending on our money as much as they did in the beginning.
No, it's interesting that matching funds, you know, for years, government grants have required matching funds from private sector.
Mm-hmm. True.
And so it's interesting now that in your way of looking at this, what you're talking about is the investment from the private sector is really kind of alongside government funds that really help sustainability more.
Mm-hmm.
So the concern would be that it looks like the government money is actually flowing back to you, not the return on the investment.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm guessing that just keeping the transparent flow, and all government money always comes with a very, you know,
lots of strings. Yeah.
Lots of strings, mm-hmm, and a very lengthy technical proposal that
and corruption. Would,
yeah, well,
there's bribery, you know. So a lot of the entrepreneurs that I personally fund are actually avoiding government channels altogether. And they are charging fees on the ground. And there's a new term that has evolved now in the kind of philanthropy we do from the Valley. It's called patient capital. So unlike venture capital, where we are saying we want our 1,000x return 5 years from now, you know, instead of that, we're saying it's okay. 10 years from now, give us our 2x return, but give us our return. So so this whole patient capital model is evolving now. And we are trying to sort of stay away from the government right now. But that said, there is, you know,
okay,
there are a lot of NGOs, good NGOs, that take huge amounts of, you know, funding from local governments.
Go ahead.
I just want to ask you about the major problems or hurdles that Ashoka fellows find when they try to implement their projects in developing countries, or even the social entrepreneurs. What are the major problems that they face in implementation?
One of the problems I've heard several fellows mention is the security to their life, because many of them are such brave entrepreneurs. They pick areas where it's very risky to work, like Hasina, who's working on trafficking. All the four women social entrepreneurs who came here, most of them had been threatened with their life. Some of the fellows have actually died. So how to be safe and secure when working on these kind of tasks is one of the challenges fellows face. And Ashoka is looking at what can Ashoka do on that front.
And a lot of that is, you know, not necessarily just mafia type stuff. Improving the situation for some group of people often is working against some established interest.
Exactly.
Yeah. So there's a lot of people who are not thrilled with the idea, I'm sure. Besides that, are you seeing the fellows, you know, to many people, Silicon Valley looks like heaven, right? And the whole system for starting something up here is so well defined. When you're trying to deal with this on a worldwide scale, especially in developing areas, what are some of the real challenges that people have just because of it being a developing economy, for example?
So in that front, in terms of the Silicon Valley networks that people here have, that is one of the values Ashoka brings to the fellows. So Ashoka is a very powerful global network, connections to governments, entrepreneurs, private sector in other countries. So Ashoka fellow usually, once they nominate a fellow, they do have access to all kind of resources and networks. So that I have not heard that being a challenge. That is one of the big value adds that Ashoka brings.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
But for other social entrepreneurs, non-Ashoka entrepreneurs, I have heard that access to networks, mentors, resources, if you want to scale with technology, having absolutely no access to good technologists or advisors. These are things that we're able to provide here when they come to Silicon Valley. For Ashoka, the main problem I've heard is the number one is the security one that I mentioned.
But that said, to Professor Dasha's point, it's very easy to get demoralized and give up. Because there are so many barriers, there are so many obstacles to these entrepreneurs. It actually sometimes breaks my heart, because I know that if the same people were here, these same kids, if they were here in the Valley, they would have, you know, succeeded about, you know, 1,000 times faster.
Yeah.
But these kids are just, they're really struggling in situations where they have government barriers, they have local barriers, they have cultural barriers, and still they're doing what what we only dream of. For example, and I'll give you a specific example. We had been part of installing a fabrication network, a fab lab. A fab lab is basically a sort of a combination of about 25 machines like laser cutters, 3D printers, lathe machines, and so on. The fab labs that we installed in India, I can just see people walking in safely, walking out. But the one that we installed in Afghanistan, actually, the women wanted access to that because they wanted to make things like, jewelry and so on. Once they figured out how to use the 3D printers, they wanted access to that. But the kind of threats that they faced in walking up to a fab lab and,
going to the building.
Yes.
Yeah.
Those challenges are enormous. And I think that actually strengthens our own commitment to saying we have to work in these areas. Because if we don't, out from the outside, if we don't reach in, development is going to take ages in these areas. And so, yes, that's, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So one of the challenges that Ashoka fellows do face sometimes is access to capital. Because especially since many of them are nonprofit models, after they're off the Ashoka fellowship, access to capital is something that is challenging. And so they do have to spend cycles and time on looking for that. And that's something where we in Silicon Valley at the chapter trying to help several of them.
Are you? Go ahead, and then I'll ask my question. Yes.
So many Ashoka fellows. Is there any, and it's very related question, is there any helping system when they are facing so many barriers? Is there any helping system to help them to cross a barrier and achieve to maybe sometimes during the make of the way, maybe some of them might too difficult to maybe the big one to create? Or what is their continuous motivation to be good, to be very successful? I'm wondering if they're in our helping system. Also, before they begin their project, is there any kind of criteria to tell them how we will measure your impact or before they go.
So, John, answering the first question and the last question first, in terms of how they will be measured, fellows do understand the Ashoka is very systematic, so it's very clear why the fellow is being selected, and they talk about what their goals are and how that's going to, how people are going to look at that. So there's a clear understanding on that. And on the first question, if I understand it right, is a question that how do they, when there are barriers, how do they motivate themselves to keep going on? And does Ashoka do something to help? Is that the question? Okay. So on the security front, taking that barrier, that is more than a barrier, it's a challenge that almost every social entrepreneur working in difficult areas faces. So Ashoka is extremely supportive of the fellows, and it is like a family. I feel like I'm part of the Ashoka family. So starting with Bill Drayton, the founder, empathy is kind of the root of Ashoka, and everyone is a family. So Ashoka is deeply kind of cares about the fellows. And so on the security front, there is a lot that's being done right now, including looking at technologies that could be leveraged. That is why the global network exists, that if fellows have challenges, they can learn from each other, or resources and advisors. In terms of fellows meeting each other, there are several events that are organized across the world where fellows and other people in the Ashoka ecosystem come together at summits and meet each other. There's one happening in Paris next week. So from all over the world, people come, philanthropists, fellows, supporters, and they brainstorm and connect. So there are several different ways this happens, but it is the ethos of the organization, starting, as I said, from the founder, that caring very deeply about the fellows. And then the other thing that's happening at Ashoka is, I didn't touch upon, but there is a new movement right now. There was a classic Ashoka fellows. But Bill's thinking these days is that every one of us has it in us to be that way. It's just the environment in which we grow up. So there is a Changemaker Schools, which is the best schools in the country that are developing people in a manner that there's empathy, team building, change, embracing change. Those schools are nominated Changemaker Schools. And Ashoka works very closely with these schools, and they're taking the lead in working with other schools. So to some degree...
Now, those schools are... Here in the U.S. or all over?
They will be all over. Right uh-huh. now, most of them are in the U.S., and okay. we have five here in okay. the Bay Area. But bringing the whole spirit of this at a very young level, and that the reason I bring that up is it's part of the answer to your question of how do they motivate themselves. I mean, Ashoka, that is why it's about people. It finds the kind of people who don't give up. They really, really, really are passionate about the cause, and that is why it's focused on people. It's just the sense of those type of people. But taking it to another level, the belief that all of us have it in us, hence Ashoka working with these schools now, is in a sense, it's a root cause way of dealing with the problem of how do the fellows motivate themselves in the face of these barriers. It's part of being that family who cares about them and the kind of people and developing those that passion for what you care about keeps them going.
Go ahead.
These organizations, typically, how do they get visibility? Asha, for example, right? Sometimes technology is the easiest piece of the puzzle, and getting people to use your tool, I imagine, would be pretty difficult. So how do they go about it?
How do they go about finding us? You mean the foundation?
No. So getting visibility. How do they engage people to use their tool or
their platform
in their community? Yeah.
The social media. I mean, I've seen NGOs, you know, in rural, most rural parts of India, for example. They are on Twitter, they have their own Facebook pages, and they leverage social media in very smart ways, even using non-smartphones, actually. So I think this is a big change that's happened, and it's serving the NGO world really well right now.
And word of mouth as well is pretty strong within a sector. So if there's someone working with schools in rural areas like the fellow Kabir, other schools within the state hear of it from teachers, from parents, and then they adopt the solution. So when there is very sector-focused solutions, they hear from each other as well. We are, that said, in our case with the fellows, we are trying to engage Silicon Valley to increase awareness. So our four women fellows working on women's rights, they came out here for a week, they gave talks at Stanford, they met philanthropists, mm-hmm. and then a lot of that was shared in the whole ecosystem. So there is a lot more that can be done.
So it's not necessary to
If it happens, it's good, you know. And but the reach is actually outside. It doesn't matter whether the government is involved or not. NGOs are able to use social media in very novel ways to get visibility in their own community first, but even outside.
And that is why, in a sense, we're talking of social entrepreneurs, both of us here, versus people working on social causes as a distinction, right? An entrepreneur finds a way, not just that they innovate. In execution, they find a way of whatever they need to do. If they need to work with the government, they'll find the partnerships. If they need to leverage government for visibility, they will. Entrepreneurs are very good at finding their route towards success, however they do it, based on the solution. All the people we are talking of, these are social entrepreneurs, not just nonprofits or NGOs or social causes. They're not just solving a social problem, they're doing it as an entrepreneur.
So certainly one of the sort of basic definitional aspects of entrepreneurship is to have this vision or something that you just cannot let, you have to do something with, right?
Yes.
I think that you see, what I think is really sort of distinctive in this is that sort of principles of good management have sort of hit the vision space mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. in things that really are not obviously companies, right? And this is certainly a positive thing. What are you worried about? What are the things that really worry you about social entrepreneurship from here, or about the visions, the ideas that are being developed in places like India? What do you worry about when you get up in the morning?
I don't.
Okay.
I'm actually just a happy camper.
Okay.
Because really, the kind of stuff that I'm seeing,
yeah,
it was inconceivable 10 years ago. So the kind of technology.
Now that's interesting. Is technology is different?
Well, technology, of course, has crept in every walk of life
in the
lowest, you know, disadvantaged areas in India. So in that regard, there is nothing. I mean, I don't worry about what I though. Just, the one mm-hmm. thing I would hope to see going forward is less of obstacles coming from a government. You know, I would like to see less regulation being imposed by government for no reason. You don't want people who are doing fantastic work in imparting learning to have to report to some guy who's sitting in the government office saying, Are you meeting these standards of regulation? And that's where windows of corruption open up. And
yeah.
So I would, let, I would
let
love
me
to
also,
see.
I saw a very interesting analysis of corruption in India in a published article. It's actually very little in the national government.
Mm-hmm.
It's mostly local.
Yes, because
and
you know,
so
that's where
when you're thinking government sector, you need to think local as well as the national.
Right.
Yeah.
Because those are the guys who are the who are presenting the barriers, right?
Right.
So my dream scenario is where, you know, government stops being an obstacle for these entrepreneurs. And
yeah.
But that said, I really think that what the path that India is on right now, is there's nothing there to really, for, personally, I don't worry about it, but I do worry about other places where we are giving in
mm-hmm.
In parts of Africa for sure, and the Saudi world for sure. I mean, I think in the Middle East is probably the scariest place as far as I go.
Mm-hmm.
And because the way I see the, when I compare entrepreneurs sitting in India and those sitting in Pakistan, or in Bangladesh, it scares me that the same caliber of talent is being squashed for no reason, because of, you know, old habits, because of old institutions, which are crumbling but still are not dead yet. And therefore, they're sitting like this 800-pound, you know, weight on the entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
They're just not letting them move. So I actually do worry about the Muslim world, to be honest, because of the cultural barriers against women and girls, about, you know, about the ease with which certain segments in the society are able to use religion to polarize the you know the civilian populations, and that worries me for sure.
Okay.
I also worry about China creeping into Africa. I just don't know. It gives me the jitters. It's like, what is going to come out of this? This much money pouring in from China into Africa. What's going on? I mean, what's the geopolitical thing going on? It worries me, but I don't have the answer.
These are things to keep up with in the news. Go ahead.
Have you attempted before to adopt projects that aim to impose cultural change in these regions where you mentioned cultural obstacles, heads on, let's say?
Well, these are at a certain
level. These are kind of invisibly subversive projects. You know, when you give a fabrication lab to some parts of Ghana, or to some parts in Afghanistan, and when you open up equal access to girls and to women, these are by definition very subversive projects, actually, because they're going to change the old system of command and control. But it's not just, we're not talking just administrative power situations. We're talking about, you know, even cultural, social institutions that will be transformed because of this activity. It'll take time, but it will transform. And so, yeah, in a way, these are pretty subversive projects, actually.
And cultural changes. Go ahead.
So you're suggesting having people get used to these new concepts for them, like girls going directly to with boys the same.
You know, we have to co-opt. I've noticed that in all my projects, mm-hmm. unless we co-opt the grandfathers in the project, our success is limited. And so since we are driven by success right now, as to how many children we are reaching, you know, we are finding that co-opting the men is much easier than fighting people. And so in Delhi, for example, I'm working with an NGO called Roshni, which works in the old parts, really sort of solid old Muslim parts of Delhi, actually. And we realized that first, you know, and it was a bunch of people from here, from all of us from Stanford, who went in and we set up this NGO. And we wanted to work with the girls, and we wanted to make sure that we gave leadership training to the girls so they wouldn't be married off at the age of 14 or 15 or something, right? So at first, the attitude was, you know, we know well, we know best, you know, and this is what, here is we are donors, you know, and this is how things should be. But, you know, after a few knocks, we actually got, we understood, we became wiser, and we said, let's see what happens if we go speak to the elder in the community. And when my NGO started speaking to the fathers and to the grandfathers and saying, and really convincing them that this is not a threat to the established order at all. This is not going to make the girl, you know, run away from home or you know, not study her Quran or anything. It's just something that will actually lift the whole community. Once we engage them in the dialogue, our doors opened up much faster. So you know, in a way, it is, you know, we are also learning in this process.
So I wanted to add one thing as well. A lot of these social entrepreneurs are bringing cultural change at some element and some level. An example of Samasur is not an Ashoka fellow, but they did very interesting things bringing livelihood. And in some parts of the Muslim world where girls couldn't leave their home, they've transformed the quality of life of the women. So in those cases, entrepreneurs innovated where rather than going to these centers from which people work, they brought the machines, they allowed the girls to and the women to get a computer at their home and work from home. And as it turned out, what Samasource does is a digital micro work, so it's things you can just do on the computer. So it's actually ideal for working from home. You do things like you look at an image and say, this is a horse, this is a computer, something humans can do much better than computers. And so what it did for these women in Muslim parts of the world is now not only were they earning, they started earning a lot more than the men in the family. And it actually really increased the respect. The father-in-laws and others in society started treating them with great respect. So it's also ways in which the entrepreneurs innovate around these issues.
Okay, good. Go ahead.
Thank you for your talk and questions and answer. I was wondering, do you find that there are changes in religious values as you do the projects and there's cultural change?
You mean more modern religion?
Yes, that means, for example, it could be any kind of religion in the country, but as maybe women go to school, maybe this might not, like for some religions, it might not be, it could be any religion, it might not be such a positive thing in the past, like women going to school, women being earning more than a man, it might not be seen very positively, but has there been changes since these projects have been underway?
I'm actually very, I live this and breathe this stuff right now. What I'm discovering is that engagement of the community is crucial, because whenever you create these cracks in the established order, there's going to be resistance. But there is no way to act and deliver results unless you work with the community. And what's interesting is, I find that a lot of even religious leaders go back to the text and actually refer to certain chapters and say, no. The original text said this, and so what these guys are doing, actually, it's okay for girls who are, getting educated. So there is a shift, but it's about, it's about being patient and about really engaging them in a respectful way. So but religious changes are happening. There's no doubt about it. I mean, sort of blindly following certain aspects of religion is being given up. As education, learning, and technology creeps into these communities.
And I would say also that as women learn more and they think through these things, things are changing. So we have an Ashoka vice president in Egypt, one of the biggest champions of women's rights. And she actually went back, and she's Muslim. She's very, very, very in a deep intellectual and a scholar. She went back and studied the Quran just so that she could have a view on these matters. And then her view after studying the Quran is actually that it's very unclear that girls are required to wear the veil. And she actually started challenging people on TV on that front. So yes, as girls get educated, they become role models, they become leaders. And they look at the nuanced situations. Things will change and are changing. But it's not going to be an easy change. And I completely agree with Asha that for the most part, it comes from within, working with the community and pulling everyone in and making them see the value. And often economic advancement actually helps. In this Leila's case, the Samasor's case, right? The fact that the families were getting more money and a lot more than ever before probably played a factor in everyone being happy about the women in the family working from home. So as there's economic advantage coming in as well from some of these solutions, that helps as well.
If I can comment briefly, though, certainly the goal is not to try to change a culture or to change a religion, except insofar as you're trying to help people.
Absolutely.
Right? Of course.
Help the people have a better situation, have access to more sustainable way of life for themselves, mm-hmm. to a better, situation of social standing for themselves. And it's kind of like, when they started Google, they didn't intend to destroy the advertising industry.
True.
But it happened. So
yes.
What? they created something,
yes.
that had value and So what you're trying to do is not really directly to threaten.
No, not
any
at
particular
all.
Not
at all.
Yeah.
It's important to recognize, we are all recognizing that religion is a subjective construct. You know, so it's not necessarily a fixed thing. I mean, one might, even in pockets of resistance. For example, in Saudi Arabia, most of you probably know about this case where this young lady wanted a driver's license, right? And it was against Muslim law, against Sharia law, I think. And she actually went back and used, you know, aspects of the Quran and its interpretations to say that it was okay for her to get a driver's license. She fought for it. She was put in the prison a few times. But ultimately, she won, and women can now drive in Saudi Arabia. But it was using aspects, you know, or interpretations of what, you know, what the law required, what even religious law required. And so that itself, I mean, that shift is you know, is intangible, Richard. You know, there's mm-hmm. You can't put an ROI on that.
Right.
But
right.
The ROI is huge. I mean, I'm sure even in our intelligence community here, we are thrilled. You know, that women are driving, women might be able to go to school, actually, because we all know that, you know, the highest return on investment, even from perspective of peace and security, is on investing in a girl, because that will change things in such a huge way, you know, for peace, if nothing else.
Yeah, for social good, and let's face it, democracy requires education, too.
Yeah.
So, of all days today, Coupa Cafe is late, so our refreshments are arriving at any time now. This is why we're kind of playing. Go ahead.
Quick question. Healing from the water side, just kind of the area that I live in, you discover any kind of lack of empathy in the Silicon Valley bubble of the ultra-wealthy?
Of the what? From
just trying to raise funds.
Do people in the Valley, are they so worried about making money for themselves that
you know,
social things are not.
So there are pockets, right? I mean, again, there are lots and lots of, you know, it's not a monolithic group in the Valley. There are lots of people who are, you know, who are, especially the immigrant community. I mean, there is no way we can sit here in any way and not be concerned about what's happening back in the homeland. There's no doubt about it. And I think this ethos is spilling over into every aspect of the Valley. Yes, there could be some pockets of, you know, people just sort of, you know, caught up in their own little bubble of, you know, making their own startup, you know, exciting. Or young people being driven by, how can I get to my IPO? It can happen. But that said, we have phenomenal role models in people like Bill and Melinda Gates. The work they are doing is so stunningly powerful and so enriching even for themselves personally and for their children. So when and now it's becoming very common. I mean, you hear Bill and Melinda Gates walking around with their kids, talking about the projects and how their work in Africa or in India or in Pakistan is enriching their own lives. And I think this is kind of spilling over into the Valley. So suddenly you do have a lot of families waking up and saying, you know, how can we partner maybe with the Gates Foundation to begin with, at least, you know, and. And so it's not as bad as one would think, you know. But that said, you know, entrepreneurs, especially technology entrepreneurs, can be in the early years can be a bit, you know, caught up in their geeky bubble, and it's a geeky bubble. It's not really a malicious bubble. It's not lack of empathy. I really think it's just a little, you know.
I refer more to the ultra wealthy VCs who've had so many exits already and are sitting on X amount of millions. And,
you know, that's where I think President Clinton and the Gates family are playing a huge role. Even Warren Buffett and his family, they're playing a huge role in opening up the minds, not only of the people in the Valley, but even in India, actually. You know, people, because India, again, is, you know, people normally leave wealth for their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Even that is being sort of re-educated now because of Clinton's traveling to these places.
And on that one, I'd like to add that I think in Silicon Valley in particular, exposure makes a huge difference. I've seen that when, I would agree that I think there are, considering the amount of wealth, the percent of giving is very low in some of the wealthy circles. But I have seen also that such people, when they come meet Ashoka Fellow or at Asha's home, I've seen when people listen to inspirational speakers, then something transforms almost instantly, and then they want to engage. First step is engaging, not giving. Then after engaging does come giving. So I think it's just a matter of exposure. And with that, all human beings have it in them, most human beings have it in them to give, and we are no different here in Silicon Valley.
It's important to also sort of communicate the quality of life aspect of giving. I mean, we all know now that, you know, the highest amount of happiness actually can be gained by doing some service, you know, and so...
Do you have, let's end up the formal session, quick recommendations for students who are interested in social entrepreneurship? What would you say that they should do to prepare?
Well, first of all, you're welcome to contact us because we, you know, are living and breathing this stuff. So please look at our websites and contact either Radhika or me. And we are happy to actually, you know, we're actually looking for, you know, interns, fellows, and we're happy in case we cannot accommodate. There are multiple networks we know around here where we can find them a job. I mean, all companies now, including eBay, Google, Facebook, they all have their own .org.
Yeah.
So you could apply there for an internship. And it's highly rewarding, actually.
Okay.
And then one other thing I would add is come engage with us at the chapter. What we do at the Ashoka chapter here is we hold receptions. So if you want to start engaging without too much time commitment, when these fellows go through town, we just have a tea, and anyone's welcome who's interested. Just meet the fellow. You don't know the commitment. If you like them, you could join the work, help them wherever there's a need, or go and intern with some of the Ashoka fellows or Asha's entrepreneurs. There could be very interesting interning opportunities. And also cross fellows, cross organizations, stands happening. Just the two of us are in the hub of many, many interesting things in the social sector right now. Come chat with us.
So I want to thank our panelists for a really inspiring session this afternoon.
Thank you.
And thanks to everybody for coming to the series this spring. Thank you very much for coming today.